Good afternoon and welcome to Moments of Hope with your humble pastor, Pastor Curtis Robert Grant, the Zion Hope Missionary Baptist Church. I hope all is well with you and your family. God bless you and keep you is our prayer, and I hope you brought your Bibles with you. For those of you that are going to join with us in our conference call, you can dial 515-606-5380, and then the access code is 636-090. And I pray that all is well with you and your family. And as we now prepare to move forward in our Bible study, we want you to look at John 4 and 8, where it simply says, "He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." And we've been talking about love in these last few sessions, and we want to continue this process. And so I want, prayerfully, that we'll be able to take away and to understand what this love look like. It's, the problem is not that we don't know what to do. Most of us just don't know how to do it. And so hopefully with these expressions and these teachings, we'll be able to gain some kind of insight of what it is that God wants for our life. And so with that being said, starting from John 4 and 8, when you look at that word love, it's the agape love. The agape love interprets itself as a love feast. And so when you look at a feast is that when people gather up, you set the table, and people come and choose and eat what, you know, and enjoy themselves with no strings attached. And so everybody is happy because it is a festive move. It's a place where people come to enjoy themselves. So this same feast that is considered is also the agape love, where it talks about benevolence. And the word benevolence is defined as a disposition where desire and choice is made to make someone else happy. And so you got to see that when you deal with this basic definition, that's all we really want to deal with today, so that we don't complicate things, that there has to be a desire that's private, and then there has to be a decision which makes the private desire become a public display. And so if you take this theory or this definition back to the beginning, before there was anything, you have to understand that God being love with nothing to love is now creating a problem, because now God has this desire and now he has to make a decision. But where does his desire focus on, and what decision does he make? Because when there is nothing to love, then you have no object to direct your love towards. And so I want to submit that this is the very desire that causes Adam to come into existence. And you have to see now that when God has this desire to love, and he has to make a decision to love, God makes the decision to create Adam. But you have to understand that Adam is not an afterthought of creation. And what I mean by that, I mean that God does not create all that he does and then turn around and say, "Oh, you know, I'm gonna make man." No, what I mean is Adam is the first thought that pushes the creation into motion. Because what God is doing in the midst of creation is he's creating everything that he thinks that will make Adam happy. As he creates the fowls of the air, the fish of the sea, the beast of the field, the atmosphere, the clouds, the stars in their sockets, all of the stuff in the world that presents the glory of God, he makes for Adam's happiness. And so now that he has created everything, then the sixth day he creates Adam. He creates Adam because when Adam comes into this world, he wants Adam to be able to experience his desire and his choice to share what he wants to share with Adam, and there is no strings attached. And so you have to understand that God created Adam in his own image, Genesis 1:26. And you've got to understand that because God does not have a body, the Bible declares that God is a spirit. And so when God creates Adam, he creates Adam in his likeness and in his image and in his likeness. And so seeing that God does not have a body, the only thing that God could have possibly created when he created Adam was a loving spirit. Because if God is a spirit, and then the Bible says that God is love, the only thing he could have created Adam to be is a loving spirit. And what Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, that God created a formed man out of the dust of the ground, which he creates the body to put this loving spirit in. And that's when Adam became a living soul. And I submit to a lot of people that, you know, you ain't living if you ain't loving. Because if you are the image of God, then what God has created you to be is a loving spirit. And then he put you in this body so that he can take that loving spirit and use that body to express that love to whoever becomes in your presence. And so God didn't create you to get a blessing. He literally created you to be the blessing. And so you have to see now that God has created all of this stuff for Adam's happiness. And so when he creates Adam, he puts him in a body. And now Adam, who is just like God, wants an object and someone to focus on so that he can take his desire and his decision and give it back to God. Now, you've got to see that God has given Adam everything that he has. And so now you have to ask yourself the question, what does Adam have to give to God? Well, he have a desire, all right? He got what he feels, and then he has a choice to make. And that choice is to tell God or to fellowship or to worship God because he is the God of his world. And understand, and this is where God teaches Adam how to be intimate. He teaches Adam how to love without touching. He teaches Adam how to talk sweet without trying to manipulate. He teaches Adam how to express and edify. Because when you are intimate and God has no body for you to kiss or to touch or to hug or to rub, anything of that nature, you have to find other means to express that love. And Adam had to find out how to worship God without touching God because he doesn't have a body. And what God does in that relationship is he teaches man how to be intimate. Okay, and what God does, watch what he does. When you look at Genesis chapter 2, verse 15, he gives Adam a couple of things. Number one, he gives Adam a house. Well, that's actually the second thing he gives him, because the first thing he gives him is a good relationship, a good, healthy, loving relationship where God blesses Adam and Adam blesses God. And that's where you get the term relationship. Okay, and so now the second thing that God gives to Adam is his own house, because God don't want Adam to be wandering around, figure out where he's gonna live. He don't want him to, you know, be in a different place every night. He wants him to be in a place where he can feel it's his own, because he wants Adam to keep his mind focused on the relationship. The third thing that God gives to Adam is a job. Because the Bible says he took Adam and put him in the Garden of Eden. He says he want him to dress it. The word dress there seems to decorate. It means to decorate. Take your house and decorate it. Make it your home. Make it some place where you're comfortable. All right? And then he gives, number four, Adam responsibility, because now he tells him to keep it. And the word keep simply means to guard it. You don't want nobody to come in and wreck what you work hard to establish. And so he tells him to keep it. And what he does with that, he teaches Adam what we call responsibility. All right? And then after that, you get to verse 17, where God says, look, now this is the tree of knowledge of good and evil. I don't want you to eat from it, because the day you eat from it is the day you surely die. And what God does here is he teaches Adam how to make good choices, because you can understand that when you have to go past this tree every day, you got to exercise free will and you got to exercise good choices, because the choice is God says don't eat from it and you've got to exercise good choices. And so God wants Adam to be able to make good choices before he does anything else. So the sixth thing that he does for Adam is he gives him authority. And so now he brings all of the animals to Adam and said, look, I want you to name them. And whatever Adam named them, the Bible says God was cool with it. And so God teaches him how to have dominion, teaches him how to have authority over. And so now he brings to Adam, the Bible says, it is not good to that man be alone. Now, understand God's phrase here, because most people, when you look at this, you see that he has a loving relationship with God. That's the first thing that God gives him. And so you have to ask yourself the question, is man really alone? Because if God is there, is he really alone? But you have to understand now, he is alone in the terms of the fact that he doesn't have anyone that's in the world that's just like him, that's got a loving spirit and a body. Because the loving spirit that God created was so that he could fellowship with God. But see, now Adam can fellowship with God, but the question now is, who fellowships with Adam? You've got to see, physically, he has to bring somebody into Adam's world that functions just like he does, because when it's all said and done and the fellowship of God and worship is over, he has to have somebody that operates in his house just like he operates. And so you have to understand, you know, I know you've been telling people that Jesus is your husband, but baby, let's be honest. After you finish praising God, running around the church, you need somebody to deal with your body. You need somebody to deal with your flesh. And the truth of it is, I don't care how saved you are, when God says, I bless you and multiply, you know, you got to understand that can be a curse if you don't use it right. And so at the end of the day, you know, you got to understand that God has put people in your life, preferably your husband and your wife, so that you can exercise this love one towards another. And so now what you see is God is giving Adam all of this stuff before he ever brings a wife into his life. Because saints, let's be honest, you got to make sure that a man has a good relationship with God. He's got his own house. He's got his own job. He knows how to take care of responsibilities. He knows how to make good choices. He knows how to exercise authority. And before God brings a woman into his life, he makes sure that Adam knows how to do all of this stuff before he even starts creating Eve. And so at the end of the day, saints, what I'm trying to help you understand is that God strategically do this so that man can know how to love before he brings a lover into his life, because all she needs to do when she comes into Adam's life is to take care of Adam, because it is Adam's responsibility to take care of her. And you got to be honest with yourself. Nobody can take care of you if he has not learned how to take care of himself. And that's a problem. You know, we going in and we calling these people, or these male people or male factors, we're calling them men, and they're not men, because if you ever go back to the Bible never tells us how old Adam was when God created him. And in other words, he never gives an age, because at the end of the day, man is not determined how old he is. Man is determined, the term man only takes on that definition when you know how to be responsible, when you know how to be mature, when you know how to make good choices, when you know how to exercise authority, when you know how to do those kind of things, then you become a man. And most people are frustrated because what they have been marrying is males perpetrating as men. And so you got frustrated because you thought the guy you married is a man and he's still living in his mama's basement. He ain't learned how, listen, first of all, he ain't learned how to take care of his own house. He don't know how to process the information to get a house. He don't, you know, he might have a job, but you know, the biggest thing he got in his life is a car, and it's sitting in somebody else's driveway, got rims on it. You know, he's spending all kinds of money on rims when he should be taking that money to put a down payment on a house. And so you got to see, all of this stuff helps you to understand that he ain't mature enough right now for you to marry him or him to marry you. Because until a man knows how to exercise good choices, you are best getting a male that's perpetrating as a man. And so at the end of the day, I want you to see that, because now what you find out is that Adam don't make a good choice. And when he doesn't make a good choice, it's because of Eve, who didn't make a good choice. And what I want to show you in these last couple of minutes is that when Adam finally ate of the forbidden fruit, 3:7 says, and the eyes of them were both open. And the expression of that phrase, if I could, I want to tell you like this. The both of them, the eyes were open to evil. All right. And listen, evil knowledge. Okay? Because before he was open to evil knowledge, all he had was good knowledge. And so good knowledge allowed him to express love without hindrance, express love without any confusion or hesitation, because when there is no evil knowledge, there is no reason not to express love in a very giving way. But the moment evil is present, it becomes the hindrance of the expression of love. And so when you see this now, he looks at his wife now in embarrassment, because evil knowledge have told him that her status ain't good enough anymore. So now he wants to create an apron to put around his wife because he's embarrassed of the fact that she's naked. Let's be honest, she's always been naked. The only thing that's changed is what was in his mind. And so now you get this reaction because his mind has been disconnected from the source of his happiness, which is God. And so, saints, you better understand that any man that's disconnected from God does not even have the ability anymore to love you like God intended for him to love you. So watch this. So now you see God showing up in the Garden of Eden and the Bible. And I want to submit that God showed up every day for fellowship, because that's why he created Adam in the first place. He created Adam so that he could be there in fellowship with Adam. But one day he shows up and the Bible says, and God comes walking in the cool of the evening, he says, Adam, where are you? Now, I believe that the word is rhetorical, where are you? Because God, being God, knows everything. And so he's not asking Adam, where are you, because he don't know where he is. I believe he asked Adam, where you are, because he's trying to get Adam to realize where he is. Because after Adam failed, I don't think Adam mentally assessed what had happened to him, because it was so spiritual that nothing physical had changed yet. And so God comes walking in the garden and he says, where are you? And the Bible says, and Adam began to respond. He says, I hid myself because when I heard your voice, I was scared and we hid. And so you see now that the love triangle has been broken, because Adam is no longer hooked to God. Adam is hooked now to his environment. And so now when you see this, you see the punishment. I want you to go to Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, 16. Because when God gets ready to punish Eve, he says to Eve, look, your births are going to be painful. You're going to suffer in childbirth. But the one thing I want you to pay attention to, and I hope you get this, he says, but your desire shall be unto your husband, and he shall rule over you. Now, I know that people have used this, but y'all, let me deal with this the way that I believe God has given it to me. I'm not, you know, saying everybody wrong and I'm right. I'm just saying this is how God has revealed it to me. The first thing you need to pay attention to is who he's talking to. He is not talking to Adam, because, you know, men feel like that they got to take control, because if God had told Adam, rule over her, then it would have been Adam's responsibility to take control. But he's not talking to Adam. He's talking to Eve. He's saying now, your desire is going to be to your husband. Do you see this? And wherever your desire is the thing that actually masters you, okay? And what he wants to say to Eve is that now that your desire is under your husband, he should not have to fight for authority. You should simply surrender and give him authority. And saints, let's be honest. Most houses are tore up today because man has to fight for authority in his own house, because women have been created, in especially in this day and time, to be their own strength. They don't need no man. You know, I got my own house. I got all this stuff. You know what I'm saying? And all of that prideful stuff. And when a man finally comes in to try to be the man, you ain't gonna let him be the man, because you used to being in authority. And what the Bible wants to say, that if you're going to ever have a relationship that's going to work, you're going to have to learn how to step down and allow him to step up. But as long as you keep flexing your muscles trying to run over him, you ain't gonna do nothing but have a headache, and he ain't gonna have a headache, and he gonna have a headache, and he ain't gonna only take a headache so long before he just get his stuff and walk up out the house. And so stop fighting over authority. Humbly just give this man permission to do what God has called him to do and be the beautiful princess that God has made you to be, and allow him to do what he needs to do for your household so that God gets the glory, y'all get the victory, and the world get a chance to see what real love looks like. Now, I got to quit right there because my time has run out, but I'm hoping that you understood what I'm trying to say to you. And so your desire is unto your husband. Surrender. Submit. All right? Don't let him have to fight for it, because, you know, he already has to fight in the world, you know, just to come, you know, just to do what he got to do in the world, and then he got to come home and fight. That's too much fighting, baby, because if after a while, if I can't find no peace in my own home, then I'm going to stop coming to that home, all right? Because at the end of the day, I'm tired of fighting. And so I'm hoping that something is said to help you. God bless you and keep you. And so if there's anyone that wants to give their lives and rededicate themselves to the Lord, you can give, inbox us your name and your number. Yes. And our membership academy will call you back to try to find out where you are and if we can assist you to get in the church. We're not really concerned about you actually being a part of Zion. We just want you to be saved and in somebody's church where you can get what you need, all right? And so at the end of the day, we want that for you because I think that you deserve to be loved. I think everybody deserves to be loved, but we got to not know what to do. We got to know how to do it, all right? And then I want to also announce that we're going to have a Laugh Out Loud virtual comedy experience with Detroit's own Mike Larry via Zoom Friday, May the 1st, which is actually tomorrow at 7 o'clock p.m. And so the cost is $10 per household, all right? And so if you want to be a part of that, we ask you to get on the Cash. You can use your Cash app, and the Cash app is $ZionMSK4800, all right? And so I ask you to come on because, you know, especially in time like that, we just need a good laugh. And so we ask that you send your money to the Cash app, get online, let's laugh tomorrow, and have a good time, and let's laugh with each other so that we can relieve some of this pressure. Amen? And so don't forget, at 1 o'clock, we have prayer every day at 1 o'clock so that we can pray for this world, pray for our sisters and brothers, pray for your pastor, pray for your president. Amen. So I know, you know, sometimes we may not like what he does, but we got to pray for him just as well. And so at the end of the day, pray, saints, because it is certainly necessary during this hour of time of our crisis. Amen? And so I'm hoping something has been said to help you, and I hope something has been said to bless your house. And so let us pray. Gracious and kind Father, thank you for what you've shared with us in this place. We ask now that you begin to take this feeble effort, bless the people that have heard it, allow it to fall on good ground that it might produce great fruit, that you be glorified in everything we do. We'll be careful to give you praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God.